this festival is our chance to like, our chance to curate what we love and know that like, if we stay true to who we are and what we love, then hopefully it connects with other people. That's how I look at it. You know what I mean? Like if you try to do what everybody else loves, then the people that love you or connect with you, they might not connect with them.
You mean like when my mother brought him home from the delivery room?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think I remember. Yeah. He was 1 day old, and I was probably 8 years old. Yeah, I think so, yeah. He had such like a sunny disposition with everyone, with his siblings, with his parents, with his friends, and he was just like impossible to hate. So I just felt that he was the kind of person that the universe would look out for, because why not, you know? He told me he had a friend named Jermaine who was pretty good at rapping.
All right, check it out. Most of y'all, probably 99.9% of y'all, don't know who the fuck I am, so I'm gonna introduce myself.
2008, probably. By that time, I'm knowing Eve for 6-7 years. Via Boss, who's my close homie. Ibe is his older brother, the coolest guy in the world. He's doing events around Queens. He's like, he's a guy. Even when he got to St. John's, like, he's doing his thing. That's what I know Ibe to do the whole time, doing his thing. And I remember Ibe sending a Facebook invite celebrating his artist getting a deal. And so people can understand, like, I'm from New York, and every single person you know has a homie who raps. And I remember, I'll never forget looking at this invite and be like, really, Ibe? You have an artist? Your man raps? That's great. Like, who gives a fuck?
I ain't saying that I'm finished, but I'm praying in advance. Cause the way your eyes glance like they playing in my pants. Yeah, ball game.
There was an artist showcase at Le Poisson Rouge, LPR, in the Village. That was like a place where like, up and coming guys would do things at. And it was Wale, Young Chris, and a guy called J. Cole. So I remember walking into Le Poisson Rouge that day and seeing Cole on stage next to Young Chris, and they're having a good time. I'm like, oh my God, Ibe's homie? This is J. Cole? This is who signed to Jay-Z? I had no idea. Cause I had been seeing him around with Ibe forever.
I moved to New York City back in 03. I went to school up here. I just came up here chasing a dream, man. I was trying to do the rap shit. A lot of people probably did the same thing, they gave up. I stuck with it, and luckily, by the grace of God, a couple months ago, I had the pleasure of signing with Jay-Z and his new Rock Nation label.
I was at my girl's house, who's now my wife, and it was right around the spot where me and Cole both worked, and he had a burner cell phone that didn't really work. No, it wouldn't charge in the house. It only charged on his car. So everybody, like Mike Rooney reached out to Mike Shaw. He reached out to me like, yo, Jay's trying to meet him today. Jay's trying to meet him today. And it was like, I'm like, oh shit, everybody freaking out. We trying to call Cole, but we have no way to reach him. So I'm blowing him up. And his phone only charges in his car. So he turns his phone off till he gets to work. Soon as he's walking into work and he opens his phone, I'm calling him like, nigga, don't even clock in. He's like, what you talking about? I'm like, come pick me up. We going to the city. He picked me up. We in the street like, yeah, man, you about to go meet you. He didn't even have gear at the time. Like, we had to rob out my crib so I could get him some clothes, son. But, like, it just so happened we so hyped, like, he stepped on dog shit. So we on the car on the way to meet Jay. We like, the fuck is that smell? Like, why this shit smell? We like, yeah, you can't go meet Jay with dog shit. Now we pull over to the side. We get like some spray. We scrubbing the shit off his shoes. And like we get there and I don't even go in the meeting because I'm like, we don't have money to pay for parking. So I'm like, I'ma sit here. If niggas tell me to move the car, I'ma move the car. You go upstairs, do what you do, him and Mike and Mark Pitts. I'm texting this nigga every 20 minutes, like, what's the word, my nigga? And he's like, bro, he's still like, he waited 2 hours. Like just in the lobby, Jay has other meetings and stuff. He weigh in, he's like, bro, I'm nervous as shit, like, you know what I mean? So I'm just trying to get an update, but I'm just in the car like, damn, this shit really happened. You know, and at the time, I'm not his manager or anything. I'm just his homie.
I'm recording it for all the people that missed it. They're going to feel like, oh, what the fuck?
Oh, man, Jacob's so cool, man. He comes in at 3 in the morning and talks his fan.
When Cole got his first show on Proof Article, I was the editor that put that together. And that's probably the first time I met Eve. Yeah. What I liked about their relationship is that they were friends. Like, Eve wasn't somebody I knew from the industry who was like, yo, I got this new artist, yo, check this new artist out, or whatever, whatever. Like, they were friends. So their kind of bond, Cole and Eve's bond, reminded me of me and my best friend growing up, where it's just like, here's Cole with all this talent, and he got his man who believes in him. And it might have worked if Cole would have got an industry manager, again, because I think the talent spoke for itself. But I don't think we get to this point because, you know, you need somebody who kind of loves you and who can champion you and who's not going to leave your side. So I think that relationship was special.
I met Eve from Dreamville my first time. Mac had a show in New York, like Terminal 5 or something like that. And I was just like, damn, like there they go. Like, cause I've looked up to like them, Drake and Oliver, Eve, like that's how I kind of was with Mac, you know what I'm saying? Him and Cole kind of like laid a groundwork for a lot of people that knew each other before and didn't meet as like this businessy manager to artist relationship. They got it out the mud together, and I feel like they set a blueprint for a lot of people.
She liked them bud with the big old chains, ride around town in the big old range. I knew it when I rocked big old chains, not a little nigga doing big old things.
We had to find something out to get an album out. Honestly, looking back, Workout is one of the most important songs we ever made because it opened the game up for us. The idea of Dreamville Records was like to build a platform that artists can not have to go through necessarily what, not just Cole, because I don't think it's a Cole thing, what our generation of artists had to go through, which was that weird time between you need a hit to drop an album and the blogs and everything. It's like, yo, like the blogs made us free, but at the same time the label wanted hits. And you know, I kind of wanted to find that medium. I'm not here to groom and be Cole. I'm here to groom, not even groom, help groom JID to be the best version of JID. Ari Lennox to be the best version of Ari Lennox. Kaz to be the best version of Kaz. Omen, Boz, Lou, Irv Gang, same shit, right? But there's certain things you gotta go through on your own to know, right? I'm blessed that like I get to work with artists that I'm really fans of, but also that like they really value my opinion, which is dope, because they don't have to.
Probably when I opened my eyes, when I came out the womb, he might have been around.
You know, leading 8 artists is no easy task, especially when one of them is one of the biggest artists in the world, you know? But I think where Eve is good at is just kind of allowing you to make your own mistakes, you know? Allowing you to find your own path. Explore your own options, you know, understanding that it's not gonna be how it was for him and Cole, for everybody else.
I went to this studio called Alito Studio at the time, and Cole was finishing the warm-up, and that's when I first met Eve. Eve always had really good suggestions in the studio. Like, yo, what if you did a drop here? What if you used that verse you did on that song on this song? And I was like, man, that's interesting. And I used to ask him, like, you never rapped? Like, you never did music? He's like, nah. He's like, bro, I just kind of got an ear of like what the common person wants to hear. We used to call it homeboy services, because it was just kind of like, a lot of these bonds were very like organic.
It's really, really some Disney movie bullshit. You know, I met Boz when I was 13. Eve went to our rival high school. Bro, it's the first time Dreamville's a real place. That's why it's love. It feel like a family reunion with these kids. But we seen kids that met online waiting for tickets having kids, bro. Come on.
It's all family, you know. I've known everybody. I've known all of them since, some of them are my siblings, some of them I've known since they was like 18.
It's corny, but it's like family shit for the good and the bad, if that makes any sense. Like, for all the positives of it being a family, there's, you know, the negatives of being a family when it comes to, you know, business is hard with family. but if the quality of the people that are in your family are good, like usually the people that they bring around are good.
It's that same family structure from when they was all broke, trying to come to my parties in New York and I would let them in, until now they're running one of the biggest hip hop festivals in the world, you know? And but the family bond, the structure is identical.
I'm such a Jay fan, I grew up such a Nas fan. But I would say my golden era was 2000 to like that 2000. I would say 8, because I don't want to count when we came in as the golden era, because that's unfair. Right, yeah. Even though I do think Cole, Kendrick, Drake, Wale, Big Sean, Wiz, I feel like that's a fucking golden era. But to me it was like Kanye, 50, Wayne. I think what Wayne more so than anything taught me is like, I feel like he taught a lot of us that your biggest song is not necessarily your most cultural impactful song.
I miss doing this shit. It's my shit. Everybody put your fucking cell phones in the sky. We gonna light this shit up. It's my favorite shit. Love yours. Love yours.
To see fucking 40, whatever, 50,000 people with their cell phone lights up, all rapping the word to a song that like was made at a point where we felt like we was at a low point, you know what I mean? Like, you could argue that that's Cole's greatest song ever.
Let a nigga know that he alive. Fake niggas, man, snakes in the grass. Let a nigga know that he a ride. Don't be sleeping on your level, cause it's beauty in the struggle, nigga. Woo! Go for all y'all. It's beauty in the struggle, nigga. Nigga got chills. I ain't did this shit so long. It's beauty in the struggle, ugliness in the success.
He went through like a time where he was trying to be everyone else. And he was trying to be the rapper everybody wanted him to be. And then he went into a point of like, fuck that. I'm just gonna be myself. Trusting your instinct, trusting your belief. Like, I feel like that's what I would tell 17-year-old Eve, even though 17-year-old Eve was just hooping, you know what I mean? He's just playing basketball. But we here, it worked out. It worked. Looks good. It's a fucking Ferris wheel.
It's a fucking Ferris.
Hey, we got a Ferris wheel. Can we get the Ferris wheel? We got a fucking colorful Ferris wheel in Raleigh, North Carolina. That's kind of hard.
Why? Because what's money without happiness? Hard times without the people you love. Though I'm not sure what's about to happen next. I ask for strength from the Lord up above, cause I've been strong so far, but I can feel my grip loosening. Quick, do something before you lose it for good. Get it back and use it for good, and touch the people how you did like before. I'm tired of living with demons cause they always inviting more. Think being broke was better. Now I don't mean that phrase with no disrespect to all my niggas out there living in debt. Cash and minimal checks. Turn on the TV, see a nigga Rolex, and fantasize about a life with no stress. I mean this shit sincerely. And as a nigga who was once in your shoes, living with nothing to lose, I hope one day you hear me. Always gonna be a bigger house somewhere, but nigga, feel me. Long as the people in that motherfucker love you dearly.
Man, my final thought for the weekend, make sure it's fucking beautiful. Like, I know, like, to see that shit, like, to have a... We not in Miami, we not in L.A., we not in New York. We bringing people to Raleigh, North Carolina. Thousands and thousands of people enjoying the music that we love.